Welcome back to the Album Written Hour YouTube channel, the home of album reviews, discography guides, and think pieces. So today's review is a review of the Mike Skinner side project, The Darker the Shadow, The Brighter the Light album, called The Streets. Now, I know that many of you may be asking, Evan, this was released on the 25th of June, why are you only reviewing it now? And the reason is, I only knew about it until a couple days ago, so I'm reviewing it now. But basically, to give you some background on this project, Mike Skinner initially dissolved The Streets in 2011, but came back in 2016 and 2017 under the name The Darker the Shadow, The Brighter the Light, where he dropped a total of, I think, 19 individual singles on Spotify and various streaming services, which is obviously enough to make up an album. And, you know, of all these tunes, I just kind of thought that some of them were good, like Looking the Wrong Way Down a Telescope or Not Playing, and there were a few others that come to mind, but mostly I just thought it was a kind of blander version of what he'd been doing with The Streets. And then when The Streets came back, what their 2017 single stuff sounded like was just a more interesting version of The Darker the Shadow, The Brighter the Light stuff. But with this new album, as I kind of alluded to in my Streets mixtape review, the Big Streets comeback album was supposed to be a soundtrack for a film called The Darker the Shadow, The Brighter the Light. And so I think with this album being called The Streets, I think this is that comeback soundtrack album. So obviously expectations are high, given that this is apparently a 2-year-old album for a film that has been at least mentioned for over 10 years now. I remember a BBC radio interview from 2011 where he talks about the film. But you know, this has been, you know, long in the works, long gestated piece of Mike Skinner creativity, whatever you like. So I had pretty high expectations going into it, although, as I say, my previous experience with The Darker the Shadow, The Brighter the Light kind of added a degree of skepticism to proceedings. But I went in with an open mind, so here is what I think of the new The Darker the Shadow, The Brighter the Light album, The Streets. The opener is called The Good in You, and is really not a very good way to start, because for starters, the beat sounds really clumsy. Like, the way the strings are sampled just sounds really choppy and amateurish and kind of unpleasant to listen to. And the beat itself just sounds really basic. Like, I get it's a classic kind of Mike Skinner-ish beat. I've heard him on a few of these beats kind of before, but it just sounds like a really basic, clumsy beat, and it's not really that enjoyable to listen to. And Mike just sounds really bored throughout the whole song. Like, his delivery is really monotone, he doesn't sound interested in anything he's doing, and the chorus in particular literally sounds like a voice note. Like, it sounds so monotone and lacking in energy, and it sounds like a weirdly grainy sound quality as well, and that's another recurring issue that I'll get into later on. But, like, it just sounds literally like he had an idea for, like, the words to a chorus and, like, put it in his voice notes in his phone, but then just decided to put that on the song anyway. So, like, yeah, both the beat itself and the vocal delivery aren't too good. I mean, obviously, there's a few witty, like, lines here and there, like the one about, if I said that's mad, it just means that I wasn't listening to whatever you said. That was quite funny. Or the one where he goes, I'm always picked last for PE and it shows, which, I mean, that is also quite funny. I mean, it's basically just a line where he calls himself fat, I think. But, you know, it's still got that signature Mike Skinner charm to it. But yeah, aside from a few witty one-liners here and there, like, I find his delivery really unconvincing, the beat is really boring and kind of amateurish sounding, and really, for your big, like, Streets comeback soundtrack album, this is a really bad way to open things up.
Come on, Lisa, let's go home. How we're bunny lad. Always pick last in PE and it shows. On my way to a...
The next track is called Don't Judge the Book, and I think sounds infinitely better for starters on a beat side of things, because as opposed to the last track, I think the way the strings are sampled in this beat is really effective. I think the kind of percussion tambourine bits that are added later on are super effective and give a really nice groove to the whole thing. It kind of reminds me of, like, maybe ABC off of Computers and Blues is the beat that comes to mind. Like, it sounds very similar to stuff that Mike's done in the past, but that doesn't mean it sounds bad by any means. And I think Mike does sound decent delivery-wise on this track as well. Kind of reminds me of his best moments off of that most recent mixtape that he dropped last year. So yeah, I do like his delivery on this. There are a few points in the more minimal kind of areas of the track where you can hear the hiss from his microphone, especially in the intro. Like, if you're listening, you can literally hear every time the audio cuts out because it's like a weird hissing noise in the background. And that's one thing. A lot of the production on this album is kind of weirdly scrappy and lo-fi for some reason, but I digress anyway. His delivery's all right, and the lyrics, the sentiment of the lyrics is done very, very well, because it seems to be about how the representation of certain areas is not at all realistic to the actual place itself, hence the hook, don't judge the book by its movie, which I think itself is a very effective chorus. And I think, although it is kind of the kind of a weird, like, echoed, shouted delivery off of the title track on the last mixtape, I think it is kind of catchy in an odd way, which I quite enjoy. But yeah, some of the lyrics that stand out, there's one in particular, it says, while Hollywood burns, the real Hollywood trailer plays right in between my ears, or something like that. Like, I think the lyrical sentiment of this track is done very effectively. But another weird production blip in this track, now that I think about it, is I think at around the 2:10 mark or something like that, where it just sounds like he was rapping and then his words got cut out by mistake, because it's like, and I'm all good for a 1940s, and then it just cuts out, and then randomly it just goes time, and then I'm like, what the hell is going on? Like, did nobody check over this to see that there were any weird production mistakes or whatever, blah blah blah? But aside from those production mistakes, like his hissing mic and the weird sort of audio edits, like, this is a very solid track. Like, the beat is done very, very well in my opinion. His vocal delivery is way more convincing than it was on the last track. The lyrical sentiment is communicated very, very well. Like, it's just a really solid Mike Skinner track, and I have basically, aside from a few minor production complaints, I basically have nothing to complain about here.
Cut to external of the smoke rising in the still, a blue light flashing in the distance. While Hollywood burns, the real Hollywood...
Track 3 is called Love at First, and to get the positives out of the way first, I do think the sample that is used within the beat is a very nice sounding one. I think the melodies sound nice, I think the way the horns sound is also very effective, and I do think that Mike's sang chorus on this is pretty effective. I mean, let's be fair, Mike Skinner, his singing ability, like, he's not exactly Pavarotti, do you know what I mean? And some of his sang choruses on the last mixtape I just found really irritating, but this one I found fairly decent, if a little strained at times. Like, when he's reaching into his higher registers, it can get a little bit iffy, but for the most part I do like the melody he's singing here, and I think it's done fairly well. Apart from that though, I do have a few complaints. Like, again, when rapping, Mike just sounds bored. Like, I don't know what it is, but I mean, the lyrical sentiment is okay. It seems to be about how you know, people don't want to get into any more relationships because they're feared that the same pain that they went through in their previous relationship will be experienced in this one, and so they don't bother meeting people. I mean, that's a fairly, you know, well-communicated sentiment throughout the track, and I think one that the chorus echoes in, do you believe in love at first sight, or should I walk past again? You know, I think that is done really, really well. My main problem with this track, apart from Mike sounding bored when he's rapping in the verses, which I do find disappointing, is the beat, because I really don't understand, because apart from the sample, what they've got drum-wise is like dubstep kick and snare, like proper fat, beefy, chunky kick and snare, but with like weirdly lo-fi trap hi-hats. It just sounds like the biggest mess ever. And they're not mixed very well either. So like, when Mike is singing in the chorus and the drums are going, he's like side-chained his vocals to the drums. So like, they dip in volume every time the kick hits, and it sounds really annoying. And the use of harps in the bridge is a very weird one, because it's not as if I love the beat at all to begin with, but like, you're just listening to the song, kind of enjoying the melodies in the background and what have you, and then all of a sudden in the bridge of the song, all of a sudden these really loud, out of place harp samples get introduced. And it's just like the most head scratching moment of the whole song, because you just sat there listening, and all of a sudden out of nowhere you just get bing, 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 and you just sat there scratching your head like, what the hell is going on? So yeah, apart from the sample and a fairly well executed chorus on this, this wasn't one of my favourites. Like, again, I just think Mike sounds way too bored when he's rapping. I think that really needs to be improved. And I think that the choice of drums on this, I really question it, because it does not fit with the track at all, and it's really a shame, because I think if the beat was a little bit better, this one probably would have been passable, because again, I think the lyrical sentiment is communicated fairly well, and the chorus is fairly nice.
You were not afraid of new love. You were just afraid of old pain. On the beach looking at sea.
The next track is called Original Sin, and like Don't Judge the Book, it's basically an all-around positive experience, because I do really like the beat on this one. It sounds kind of nice and psychedelic and ethereal, kind of like maybe The Phone Is Always In My Hand off of the last mixtape or something like that. And while they are mixed a little bit weird, and maybe they can get a little high-pitched and kind of awkward sounding, I do think Mike's sang flows and his lyrics work fairly well on this song. Like, again, when they do get a little high-pitched and a little sort of like strained and a bit warbly, they can sound a bit awkward, but that's only very occasionally, and for the most part he sounds engaged, he sounds compelling. I'm not sure I have any idea what he's talking about on the lyrical side of things, but I do enjoy his vocal performance on this song, and I do think it goes very well with the beat as well. And I think that in the chorus, the use of a kind of pitched up female vocal sample is a very effective one, because I think it does serve its purpose within the track and also kind of fits the style and the vibe of the track very well as well. So yeah, this isn't one that I have an awful lot to say about it, but the stuff that I do have to say about it is very positive. Like, again, I like the kind of psychedelic atmospheric beat. I like the use of the female pitched up vocal sample in the chorus. I think Mike's vocal delivery and, you know, his lyrics are fairly like engaging and compelling, despite the fact that, again, lyrically, I'm not really sure too much what he's going on about. But I do like this song, basically, and I don't really have much else to say beyond that, apart from that I like this song. And it's probably one of my favourites on this whole mixtape, actually, or album, rather.
Blood on my fingers, running in rivers, triangles of mirror, star working shards, Mother Mary and...
The next track is Act Nice, and is another one of my favourites. For starters, I really like the beat on here. I think the acoustic guitars they chose are very effective, and I do think the drums sound very nice as well. I mean, yes, upon first listen, they may strike you as being a little off-kilter groove-wise, and that is definitely true, but I will also say that once you kind of adjust yourself to them, they do kind of have a nice, casual, sort of lolloping, laid-back quality to them that I like a lot. And going along with that, Mike's sung flows on here are similarly relaxed, casual, very nice, and the lyrics are also very endearing as well, because it seems to be about a kind of relationship dynamic where the other person who isn't the speaker in the track is kind of always sort of pent up and stressed all the time and kind of pessimistic, and then the speaker in the track, being Mike, is kind of like, yeah, I know you're stressed out a lot of the time and you're kind of pent up and all this, and that's fine, you don't need to apologise, but just like, you know, try and chill out every once in a while, which I think is a nice kind of endearing statement, and I think it goes along with the kind of vibe and feel of the track very well. And I do think that the sung chorus on this is a very effective one. It's easily the strongest chorus on this whole album, in my opinion. I think that Mike's melodies are very strong, and I think the background vocals he makes use of on the tail end of the chorus are also very nice. My only problem, really, and this isn't even really a problem if I'm honest, is the sort of small 20 second beat switches that come in like the last minute of the track, which are a little out of place, but to be fair, they are very short, and they do actually sound alright in isolation. Like, if they were on a different, more kind of brooding track, they would probably fit right in, but I mean, just in the context of a more kind of chilled out, laid back song, they do seem a little out of place, but to be honest, I'm adjusting to them, and I do quite like their utilisation in the track now that I think about it, because they do kind of serve as a nice contrast, and again, they do sound good in isolation. But yeah, just to reiterate what I've just said, this is basically just a nice, chilled out, kind of endearing, you know, just relaxed Mike Skinner jam. Like, he's good at these songs, I will say. He's good at doing more, like, hype songs, obviously, like on Original Pirate Material. That album is basically just hype songs pretty much all the way through. But as this song shows, he also can do very good chill out songs. Like, he's shown it before on tracks like Dry Your Eyes and Maybe All Goes Out the Window. And if this track shows anything, it shows he's still got it in that department.
Don't apologize, just act nice for a while.
Track 6 is Love Is an Aching Tooth. And to start off with, I do like the beat on this song. It kind of reminds me a little bit of maybe Take Me As I Am off of the last mixtape, but maybe a more kind of trap version of that. Like, it's got the same fast, energetic, kind of pummeling feel of Take Me As I Am, but instead of like drum and bass breakbeats, it's like just straightforward trap drums, which I do think sounds good. It's just a shame that everything on top of the beat completely ruins it. Like, for starters, Mike just sounds bored again. Like, I don't understand what it is, but on so many of these tracks, he just sounds so boring and comatose. Like, it's just so monotone. And I don't think his flows fit with the beat either. Like, he's doing a melodic flow, but because the beat is very, very minimal, there's almost no melody to go with, so it just sounds really clumsy and awkward and out of place. And even when the melodies do come in, which is only about halfway through the track, initially, they just sound so quiet that they might not even be there. And when they do come in more prominently, maybe after the 2 minute mark with the horn melody that gets introduced, I do like it. But because the drums are kept at such a constant volume, they overpower the horn melodies. Like, the drums are loud, but when there's no melodies there, you don't really notice. But as soon as a melody that you can actually hear pops into the track, you suddenly realise, oh, these drums are way too loud, and it kind of ruins the enjoyment for you. And it's not as if Mike has any kind of witty one-liners to fall back on, because some of these lyrics are really cringy and awkward as well. Like, there's that one line that absolutely does my head in, where he's like, drawing blood with your fangs out, thinking Dracula hangs on TikTok. Like, come on, man, what are you talking about? And again, he just sounds so bored, because in that line, he literally delivers it like, drawing blood with your fangs out, as if Dracula hangs on TikTok. You make people angry, but angry people click more. And he just sounds so bored with everything he's doing. So how am I meant to sound engaged if he doesn't even sound engaged? It's as if he had like a deadline for this album, but like he just couldn't be bothered, and he realised like he hadn't recorded this song. So he's there at like 11 o'clock at night, just cannot be arsed, just being like, you make people angry, so angry people click more. And then he just saved that as the track, because again, the beat sounds nice, but as soon as melodies get introduced, you realise the drums are way too loud. Mike sounds boring and comatose. Some of his lyrics are kind of odd and cringy. Again, that Dracula TikTok line makes me wince every time I hear it. And I'm going to be honest, this is easily my least favourite track of the whole album, because again, apart from the beat in isolation, there's basically nothing that's enjoyable for me here.
Dark in the blood with your fangs out, as if Dracula hangs on TikTok. You make them angry, but angry people click more.
The next track is called Obviously You Don't Count, and is a mixed bag, but I'd say a mostly positive one, because for starters, I do like the attempt at a more kind of glitchy, laid-back, poppy style of beat this time around, and I think it does work fairly effectively. Like, I like the stuttering sampled melodies in the beat, I think they utilise fairly well, and I think the groove of the drums is a fairly nice one as well. And Mike's sung flows on here, sometimes they are good, and sometimes they do fit with the vibe of the song, and you can sing along with them, and they do sound quite nice. But sometimes, maybe the way he flows with his words is a bit awkward, or maybe his vocals can get a bit strained or weirdly pitched, and so that kind of puts me off a little bit. So I'd say it's inconsistent vocally on this song, but it's not like absolutely horrendous, which I guess I can sort of forgive to a degree. And I do think the chorus is a fairly nice one as well, because I think the way Mike sings it is very effective. I think the way the drums shift and the melody shift in the chorus is a very nice one as well. It gives it a bit more impact while not sounding out of place, because this is a very laid back track, so obviously in a chorus you want to give it a bit more impact without it just sounding like psh, 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 psh. And I think Mike does that very effectively, because he kind of keeps the bouncy quality that the drums have had throughout the song, but just gives it a bit more of a flourish, a bit more of a kind of grand presentation, and it works very well. So yeah, aside from some like inconsistent vocal abilities shown throughout the song, I do think this is fairly pleasant. I like the beat, I like some of Mike's sung flows, I like the chorus, I think the lyrics, I can't really tell what they're about, but they do seem fairly kind of endearing and kind of, I think they're maybe supposed to be wholesome from what I can glean from them, and I think with the way that the track sounds and the kind of vibe that it's going for, I think that is kind of done fairly well if I had to make a judgment on that. But yeah, like overall, this is just a fairly poppy, happy, fun sounding track. Like, yeah, it is a bit short, but it definitely does leave an impact, I would say.
Said I wouldn't tell anyone, but obviously you don't count. I said I wouldn't tell anyone.
The penultimate track is called We All Need an Enemy, and similar to Obviously You Don't Count, is a bit of a mixed bag, but I'd say it's more negative than positive this time around, if I'm honest. Like, on the positive side of things, I do quite like the way the beat sounds. It's kind of like another relaxed, chilled out kind of beat, similar to Act Nice, but maybe a bit more trap-centric this time around, which I don't mind. I do quite like the guitar sample, the drums groove fairly well. I think it's maybe a little loud on the bass side of things, but that's not too much of a problem. And I do think Mike sounds good here as well. He's got that kind of, again, similar to Act Nice, kind of laid-back, chilled, relaxed, almost kind of endearing quality to his vocals, which I guess makes sense given that this seems like it's trying to be this kind of emotional, anthemic, motivational kind of song, which I think, at least in the presentation of his vocals, it puts across fairly well. Apart from that though, one of my main problems with this song is that Mike's vocals, while they do sound okay, like the melodies that his vocals are singing aren't as like, they don't pop out as you as much as the melodies on other tracks have done. And that's the main thing with this track, is that really it doesn't pop out as you as much. Like, obviously the lyrics and the melodies and the beats on previous tracks haven't obviously all gone over brilliantly 100%, but they were still like hooks or beats or flows that you could latch onto, whereas this just tends to fade into the background really, really easily, which again isn't necessarily a problem because, like I say, it sounds nice. Mike sounds fairly chilled and relaxed, and it sounds kind of endearing and warm and nice, and that's all okay. But you know, it just, again, it sinks into the background way too easily. And when I'm trying to pay attention to the lyrics, they don't entirely sound great. Like, we all need an enemy, Paul needs a terrorist, Laura needs an ally, you found love in a hate group. Like, I have no idea what he's talking about. I guess it's kind of saying that humans need something to be able to rebel against or kind of be against in order to live a kind of prosperous life, or that, you know, each human's kind of enjoyment of things or reliance on things is subjective to them. But I really couldn't tell you, because even when I'm trying to pay attention to the lyrics, aside from the ones that I've just mentioned, they just seem like a load of kind of non sequiturs one after another. And because of how kind of laid back and chilled the track is, I genuinely couldn't pull you another lyric off the top of my head, because they just all sync in with each other. So yeah, again, while it does sound fairly sort of positive and nice, and it's got a decent vibe to it, I suppose, if you're just looking for some like positive background music, when you actually try and listen to it and pick it apart, because of how chilled out and kind of relaxed it sounds, there's not really much to get your teeth into beyond that it sounds okay.
Listen to the music on the move, jingle of the city on a loop, linger on a picture of a beauty, Wall Street, Main Street.
The final track is called Power of Love, Love of Power, and is a track that, aside from a few minor annoyances, I quite like, if I'm honest. Like, for starters, I really like the piano sample on this. I think it's chopped up very effectively, and I think the way it meshes in with Mike's vocals is also very effective, because similar to the last track, he's kind of going for a more laid-back, kind of aloof delivery, but because the piano melody is so strong, he kind of lets that do the heavy lifting, but at the same time, it doesn't take anything away from him, because he does have a very effective vocal delivery that fits in with the track very well. And I think that the piano itself almost kind of sounds a bit 80s power balladish. It's kind of like the trap equivalent to an 80s power ballad, or at least the hip hop equivalent anyway. And I do think the chorus is a fairly strong one. I think the melody is done very well. Again, I think the kind of transition in the piano chops is a fairly nice one. Maybe the vocals in the second half of the chorus are a little bit shaky when he's like, "When I needed you," like, that's a little bit weird on the vocal side, but you know, it's not too bad. Really, my main problem with this track is one tiny production detail that, once you kind of register it and it gets in your brain, it really annoys you. Like, I do like the drums on this track as a whole. I think they have a nice bouncy quality to them. The drum and the snare, they kind of have a nice pulsing feel to them, like a cool sort of, again, bouncy groove. But then the hi-hats they choose to put on top of it just don't fit. Like, I think if they had maybe the drum and the snare just by itself with a different hi-hat sound, this would sound so much better. But it's kind of like that, again, more trap style kind of sprinkler hi-hats that they put on top of it, and it just doesn't work, because again, the drum is going for a more pulsating groove. So when you've got the drums in the back going doof 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 doof, you've got the hi-hats on top of it going tss, and it just doesn't fit, in my opinion. Like, the drums themselves, again, on their own, sound okay. It's just when they're paired with those specific hi-hats, it kind of bugs me a little bit, because I think, apart from that, this track would have been a really good way to end it, because I think, all around, it's pretty solid. It's just a few minor like complaints with maybe some of the vocals, but mainly like that, those hi-hats, those are the things that annoy me about this song. So yeah, apart from that, this is a pretty good way to end off, if I'm honest.
They use you and then use you up. They can't use you if you're useless. There's two kinds of people.
So what did I think of the brand new The Darker the Shadow, The Brighter the Light album, The Streets? Well, what I'll say is this. This is pretty much what I expected from A Darker the Shadow, The Brighter the Light album, in that it basically just sounds like a cheaper, more underproduced version of what The Streets have been doing lately, and that's really a shame, because it follows that same trend that I've had with Darker the Shadow, The Brighter Light, in that, yes, some of the songs are okay, like there are at least four songs on this album, out of the nine that are on here, that I could say that I liked. Like, it's not exactly a taxing experience either, listening to the album, because it doesn't even break half an hour, so it's not like this is a really long, taxing listen. It's just a shame that this is basically just a more low-budget, underproduced version of a Streets album that kind of feels like it had a bit less care put into it than everything the Streets have been doing has been up to this point, which is really a shame, because if you think about it, this was supposed to be the big Streets comeback album. And so for the mixtape that preceded it, it's just for something to tide fans over, to sound overall probably better than this in pretty much every regard, is really a shame, because again, this was supposed to be the big Streets comeback soundtrack album. And you know, I think there may be a slight problem when I listen to this album, which again is very short, which I guess is kind of a shame, because maybe you were expecting something a bit more substantial, but still, there is a bit of a problem where, like, after listening to the big comeback soundtrack album, you sit there afterwards and go, yeah, I think I'm gonna check out the mixtape actually. Like, yes, again, like I've said over and over again, there are some tracks that I like, but for the most part, this is just pretty disappointing, honestly. So if I had to give a score, it would probably be like a decent 5 if I had to say. Like, again, there are like a fair few enjoyable tracks on here, but for the most part, it's just a kind of low-budget Streets album is just the way I would describe it, which is really a shame. So I hope you enjoyed. If you did, please consider liking and subscribing. It would really mean a lot to me. Thank you so much for 100 subscribers. It really means a lot. I had so much stuff planned when I hit 100 subscribers, so I am working on all of that. There are at least 4 videos and 1 video series that I wanted to do after I hit 100 subscribers, so all of that is coming. Stay tuned for that. There's so much stuff coming down the pipeline. Another review coming out, another Not So Friends at Record Society coming out, like there's loads of stuff. So just keep your eyes peeled, and until then, I'll see you all later.